front of the chow hall,
yeah.
Probably even worse.
I own the chow hall.
But what is it called now?
The GPAC.
In Tanzania, they all eat off the same plate.
Day, right?
So, that's what we saw in that video. They just had one plate and everybody ate off of it, right?
Like this ugali, instead of cutting, putting in a plate, you just get like this from there. Everybody's taking from there. You dip in your own stew and you eat.
Mm. Very good.
How do you put
good
the...
Good job, Chris.
Thank you.
It's good.
The beans in the...
Tom. Say Tom. Tom is good.
Tom?
Mm-hmm. Chakula to Tom.
Chakula.
Sweet.
Hmm?
I thought Tom was sweet.
Sweet in... we use sweet like sugar, we say Tom.
I'm starting to think he's making
it
up.
Good. It's Tom.
Let's go to the big book and find out if he's telling the truth.
Hey, did you ever pick up your book? Because, I mean, like, I forgot to pick mine up.
I picked it up before he gave us his book. So I have it. I just have to start listening to it.
Mm-hmm.
So I can...
The other Radazi we have are better. Why are...
So what did you do differently for this one?
Cooked them too long? No. It's too hot? It's too hot?
They're harder. Yeah. I don't know, they still taste good, but hers were better.
Mm-hmm.
Is that his fiance's?
I don't know who made those.
Mm-hmm. One of the Tanzanian lady. She lives here in Montgomery.
There's Tanzanians that live in Montgomery?
Like, three.
That's
three.
Very
surprised.
Is that where you got the clothes from?
Hmm?
I thought you brought that. With you or something like that.
How to make madazi? I learned this before. But the one we brought, which we ate before, it was made by Tanzania lady living in Montgomery, in Prasville.
They were cut into little triangles and they were all the same perfect
shape.
Yeah, I think a different pan and not quite so brown. They need to be in a skillet. Yeah.
And a flatter skillet or what?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I like
so I'm the only one that's eaten on the
fourth,
okay.
I'm going to start.
I didn't know everybody's using hand.
Well, a couple of us are.
Maybe we need to get, yeah, because I wanted to kind of get rid of my shyness.
Yeah, that's you, all right.
So where are you two hoping
nice.
To go?
I'm not really, I put UCOM as my first choice, but chances of that happening are probably pretty small.
B-52 pilot UCOM.
Well, there's a couple of
bits
there for it. UCOM is one of the commands, combatant commands that has bomber slots in it. There's not very many.
No, PACOM does. That's my friend's
yeah.
One.
PACOM and UCOM, I think, are the only ones. SOUTHCOM doesn't have any. Yeah, NORTHCOM does.
UCOM or PACOM would both be pretty cool.
Yeah. I'll probably end up in Global Strike Command, though. Because that's what they're standing up right now, and that's where all of the vacancies are.
Yeah. People just...
But then that's, you know, there'd be new opportunity because it is a new command.
Mm-hmm.
Where was I a couple weeks ago? We have a Global Strike Command. So.
Yeah, there was a general that came over to speak to us about what is it.
I know. I forget.
What was it? Joint? Something. I don't know.
It is one thing when you are on a joint staff, and I was on the joint staff. Everything else was on the Air Force, and they're like, yeah, okay, whatever. So we had stood up the new command and everything, and kind of missed out on stuff. But Joy was awesome. It was an incredible job.
No, you guys are going to graduate after we graduate.
How long were you there?
June 17th.
Just like,
I
got out
for
2 weeks. So.
We can have
to
start
from
after.
Andrews then to the joint staff.
That's how they keep
I am. I went to IED for a year with LRS.
Yeah, from like... Yeah,
Andrews, and then I went to the joint staff for 2 years. I know I'm here, now I'm going back to ID for another year. I move a lot. I'm going to be the deputy MSG. Which will be, if you're going to do that job, ID
is probably
a
good place to do it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm pretty psyched. Although it seems like I was just there.
Who's going to be the group commander?
Person I've got.
Who?
Corey Ock.
Must be a fast burner.
Yes.
Did you know that assignment sort of before you started War College?
No, and actually I did not compete to be a deputy. Mm-hmm. I got called like a week before Christmas or something, and they said, hey, we decided we're going to compete you. And the first records went in like, because you're supposed to get to this process, and I'm just like, we're going to do it. So the first base to pick was LUD, and they set my records, and that was it. So... There was no. I actually got an email on Christmas Day saying, okay, this is your official, artificial notification. All right, then.
Pass me this, too.
My parents were like, what are you going to know? I'm like, I was visiting them in Illinois. And I said, as soon as I get back, because I'm going to pull up my military email, and there's going to be a note in there, I guarantee. So that's what happened.
So Tom, what's your background?
I'm just like Chris's, I'm Melville.
Okay.
I came in as a log planner, and then did supply, then have a little bit of maintenance. So I'm still waiting to find out where I'm going.
Yeah, I found out really early. Just because they had to fill those overseas, they had to fill those remote billets first, so everyone else will find out a little later.
Yeah.
Our assignments start flowing hopefully the last week of February, otherwise the first week of March.
And I had wanted to get ahead of all you guys with my orders, but since I have to have my physical before they'll give me my orders, and it takes a month to get the physical scheduled.
You still get it scheduled?
A month. Oh my
God.
A month. 1 month.
And then they could go in for major surgery or anything.
I'm like, I was just there for a year. I just had my PHA. I'm clear.
You should be good to go in.
But
you want some?
Yeah.
What do you say?
Mine does.
What?
Something.
You want some more mandazi?
I do. Just press one. Thank
that's
you.
The way it works for us now is we have no say. We're not allowed to. We're not allowed to even say where we'd like to go. The only thing I could tell the assignment guys was, I said, please not DLA. That was the only thing I could say.
Although, every LRO 06 that has gone there has left to become a companion.
Well, my old boss is now the senior Air Force person in DLA. And I don't want to work for him. I just...
Sarah Kunkel's there, and he's pretty cool.
No, General Alan Chambers is commander of DLA Philadelphia. And when we homeschool, so if we went to Philadelphia, Pennsylvania has some of the worst laws in the world, in the states, for homeschoolers.
Mm-hmm.
So we definitely don't want to go there.
Right, DLA is in Defense Logistics Agency?
Yeah.
Really?
Plus, they don't have, just because you go there doesn't mean you got to be going into a joint slot.
Mm-hmm. So that's true.
So I have friends who are in DLA that aren't even in joint slots. It's like, yeah, I saw the writing on the wall when they put me here. But.
Well, they do it, isn't it like, oh no, that's Michigan. They have another inventory control point in them, or whatever they call their big warehouses.
In Philadelphia, Richmond.
Michigan, Battle Creek, no?
That's not DOA.
Oh, it's not?
There's one in Europe. That one's bad.
There is like one in, I think the two big ones though are Richmond and...
In Philadelphia.
Yeah. Oh, Columbus.
Oh, wow.
Columbus, best cap secret. I took
the
J4 there and Mr. Ivany last year.
Yeah.
It's like this Taj Mahal building off the airport. Brand new. Everything's gorgeous. It's run by a one-star Army general in there.
Yeah, they're all one-star.
And you could just tell that people liked to work there. who couldn't? You know, you're in Columbus, this gorgeous building, and I, the one LRO in the building, you know, found me. But they have like a little, some cool, it's just best kept secret. And that all the civilians there, mm-hmm. like the SESs, they had all retired O6s who've been working there, who then
really hyped it up.
You know the deal. Yeah.
I wish that Mr. Andy had retired. He was one of the few people that supported me on the air staff.
I was so lucky. So he was really close to our SES, the one that's now at NDU. So they would like drag me along on stuff, and then he ended up going with the J4 to Columbus, and I took her.
Missouri.
I took her to Bright Pat to see a material command and stuff. So I'm like running around with Imani and the three star. It's pretty cool, actually.
Dude, that's something like to have the insight, like to be able to shadow a senior commander,
yeah,
a senior.
Who's it actually for?
Yeah.
Mr. Imani used to do this to me. Tom, get my office.
Like coconut.
Indirectly, I worked for him because exec services worked for me,
mm-hmm.
and we had just done a reorg, so it was like a split personality situation. We supported the front office, but we worked under P, so I worked for General Pyre. So if she ever saw me coming out of his office, she'd be like, "So what are you talking about?"
Yeah.
But when I was in his office, it was, "You weren't in my office. Do these things for me, but you weren't in my office. You're not allowed to tell anybody." I'm like, he's a three star, she's a two star. She writes my ticket.
And for a while there, he was the acting A4, so.
But it was weird because the dynamics of the military generals and the civilian SESs, the military generals did not like the SESs. It was like, it was interesting.
Which is weird because Mr. Imani is so level-headed and...
He's very personable.
Mm-hmm. I mean, when I was working joint doctrine in the Air Force and the Army, we were fighting over like two sentences. I'd just go to his office, "Sir, here's what I got. Does this work? What do I need to change?" And he'd change our words. And then I would run down to somebody to the G4's office. "Okay, here's what we got. Change one more word," and then he'd run back.
The same word that the other guy changed, right?
Yeah.
And we finally got everything out.
But you definitely didn't want to lose something in Mr. Andy's desk.
No.
You go in his office and there's papers
this
everywhere.
His whole table.
But he knew where everything was.
Yeah.
Like he had paper everywhere.
This is all a little filing system, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it's all in his head.
And here's the civil engineer
mm-hmm.
by trade.
Mm-hmm.
Retired 06.
We thought Mr. Dunn was going to move up to take his spot. Mr. Dunn's like, "There's no way you could pay me enough for that job." He's A for I, the guy. He was the lean logistics. He still is a lean logistics guy, but he was a APSO 21 until they moved, made it his own organization.
How's the stew down there? We have a little more stew on the stove. If I need to bring any more up?
I'm stuck.
Oh, I don't need any more, just if I need any more in there.
Yeah, I'm good.
Now I'm going to be able to finish this.
Yeah. Oh, you are.
That's my tongue. Tongue, and toes.
What's more? What does
he? You mean Shiba.
Shiba means...
Shiba. Yeah, you mean Shiba. I'm full. Mimi Shiba.
Mimi Shiba?
Yeah. Mimi Shiba?
Mimi Shiba.
Okay, so when we're over there, if we go out in the villages, we're going to have to eat with our hands.
They would give you a spoon, thinking that you've come from America.
What
don't
should
know.
We do?
Let's just put a spoon aside and eat your food. They would be very happy.
Okay.
That's it.
So
it
would be better to do it with our hands?
Yeah, because they're going to be using their hands.
But in Burundi and Rwanda, do they eat like that? In Uganda, I know they do, but Burundi and Rwanda?
Yeah. Oh, that's...
They're Francophile countries.
You think they'd be...
Yeah.
As compared to...
Cities that is causing damage on the culture, because you may see some stuff in the village. So I expected they are... more village life that they already modernized. That's the bad thing. Because when
thing,
people go to the city, they come back, they introduce that, they introduce
we're
that.
We're not going to see too much, actually.
The villages?
Yeah.
Actually, I told Dr. Bruce, I went, I don't want to see the tourists, I want to see,
I
want to see
life.
Africa.
I mean, he's not going to take us to like the villages, dude.
But you are, I mean, we're going to see
if you
cool stuff in Burundi.
They should take you. That's what you mean.
In Burundi, are we going to go to the villages?
Well, when we do the whole, the second day, we're going to see stuff. Because between going down Lake Tanganyika and then fisheries and all that, we're going to be out.
So it wouldn't be too much, like, but it's villages where they, like, I mean, they live kind of the traditional lifestyle, but
Or they have
a
bus stop
like,
for tourist group stop here.
Yeah, like a tourist.
Tourists
attraction.
Don't really go
don't
to Burundi. And if I got my little Lonely Planet book over there, the entire, there's like 6 pages devoted to the country of Burundi. Yes.
And the book is on Africa?
It basically says, don't go out after dark. There are good, there's the expats there, so there's good food and stuff. They have a brewery.
That's what I say, there's not much sea in the Burundi. There's not much to see.
No.
But you're going to see people, the villages, that's could be very interesting. Make sure. Don't take them to the beach or whatever. Just go inside. Then see people fetching water. Follow them. Like that move. Follow where they're going to fetch water and see. There you find the real life.
Yeah, but we're not gonna be. I mean, like we're gonna be in the city center, right? Or wherever in some resort.
Hotel.
See, whoever is planning for you, he's gonna make sure that you are.
Well, she's planning Burundi.
Yeah.
She's our country planner for Burundi.
Who's planning for Rwanda?
Rwanda is Matt, and then Preston is the Marines doing Uganda.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But both 3 countries, you're going to see the heart of people. You will feel it, the way they will approach you, the way they will greet you. All. So you can see more on your social life.
Yes. Thank you.
You need to spend energy.
So how long are you going to be gone? Like 2 weeks, right? So
it's not the summer.
Certainly have the opportunity to.
It's three countries in 2 weeks, and we can fly from country to country. You can probably walk around.
Me too.
I have to have just a little bit more
than 1 week. We have to fly from country to country because the embassies are basically. You will fly from country to country.
It's funny.
Yeah.
Because we want to take the bus and like, no, go fly.
Yeah. When every embassy said that.
Easy.
I am.
They only have one plane in Tanzania. You're going to take the one plane.
Oh, now business people, they are buying planes.
Yeah.
The big ones, there might be a few, maybe 2. Yeah, they're boring. But the small ones, they may be many.
So Chris and I, with Dr. Burgess, Baron, and I think Colonel Fisher, we're doing the safari. Everybody else is going to go hike with the gorillas.
Oh, yeah?
I'd do that for $500 to go hike with the gorillas.
Up Kilimanjaro?
No, we're not going to Tanzania. This is going to be Uganda. No, it's the Rwanda part.
In Rwanda. Don't worry about those progestins. I just have to clean them up and put them in the dishwasher.
So Preston has Rwanda then.
No.
So you're going Burundi, Rwanda, and Uganda.
So we fly into Burundi, and we fly out of Uganda.
And we fly from each other, so that takes a little time, some of the logistics of it.
And the internet won't tell us what the going rate is for women, so I'm trying to figure out how to pay for the TV with 3 ladies.
100 cows.
Maybe I will offset some of the points. So she is kind of a show.
That was funny, the West Africa guys, that was more of an issue for them. You do not go out by yourself. You will stay with the group.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you will be kidnapped.
Doesn't really give you a warm fuzzy.
Whereas us, it's like there's the parties at night, and we really haven't been told what we can and cannot do yet. You probably have.
Well, it was funny, and with Burundi, the transportation guy from the embassy, we were talking about vans versus SUVs, and so just give us vans. And he said, well, the SUVs will give you more opportunity to do stuff at night.